Okay, so welcome to this 17th lecture. Now we are actually ready to go into two-dimensional analysis. Now we'll start with a magnetostatic problem, right? In which you have a rectangular conductor with carrying some current I, which is enclosed in some boundary, rectangular boundary. Obviously, you know the current is going in here, so you'll have field lines in clockwise direction. Right, and here the dimensions are given. Please note, actually, you know, this boundary is considerably closer to this conductor. If you want to analyze field of this rectangular conductor in isolation, then this boundary has to be really far away so that the boundary condition doesn't affect the field distribution. But since we want to demonstrate you the corresponding FEM code, we have taken boundary which is very close so that we can explain. But eventually, when we write a code for this, we can always, you know, take this boundary far off so that that boundary condition doesn't affect the field distribution, right? So why I'm saying it will affect, because you will impose say a equal to magnetic vector potential, you will impose a equal to 0. Moment you impose a equal to 0, you are basically influencing the field distribution, is it not? Because this boundary is closer to the conductor, right? So more about it later. So now the governing equation for this magnetostatic problem is simply del square Az is equal to minus mu Jz. As we have discussed earlier, in two-dimensional problem, as in this case, we are taking cross section which is perpendicular to the current, right? So the direction of current and therefore current density J is fixed, it is in Z direction, right? So is the direction of A, so direction of A also gets fixed, right? So that is why it is both A and J, they get replaced by vectors, field vectors, they get by replaced by Az and Jz. So effectively this reduces to scalar Poisson's equation. Is it not? Otherwise, it would have been a vector Poisson's equation with three components, that also we have seen in basics of electromagnetics, right? So it reduces to scalar Poisson's equation with only Az, you know, at various points in the domain to be determined, right? So now the corresponding functional is this. Now you are very familiar with this kind of expression. Functional is given by this. So this you have, like, in case of electrostatic, you have epsilon E square, here you have 1 upon mu del A square. In basics of electromagnetics, sometime back I explained to you, always when either mu or epsilon, when they appear singly, there, you know, if epsilon appears in numerator, mu will appear in denominator. Half epsilon E square got replaced by one more mu del A square, right? And then of course J A D S, this is appearing on the right hand side, so this term gets multiplied by the corresponding potential in the functional expression. This also I had explained, right? So this functional expression is the, it can be directly written based on the theory that we have seen earlier, right? And then the boundary condition is Az equal to 0. That also I have explained to you earlier, Az need not be 0, Az can be some other number like 50 or 100. All the values of A will then get shifted by corresponding values. Flux distribution, flux flowing between two points is just a difference between the corresponding two points, the A at corresponding two points, A1 and A2. So reference potential, even if you change from 0 to something else, the field distribution corresponding Bx, Bi values will not change. Is it clear? So that is why, but for simplicity, we always take in magnetostatic problems or magnetic field problems, whenever we impose boundary condition in terms of A, we take A as 0 and as reference potential. Clear? So now the FEM procedure, we have already seen this, is summarized here. First we discretize, here since it is 2D, we will have either, you know, triangular or quadrilateral elements, not the, just the segments. then we approximate solution. In 1D, we approximated approximated solution as a plus bx. Here it will be a plus bx plus cy, right? Then assembly of global coefficient matrix. Now, when we say assembly of global coefficient matrix, what effectively we are doing? We are actually adding energies of all elements. That is effectively, you know, that global coefficient matrix is representing the energy of the entire, you know, domain. So, because those global coefficient, that global coefficient matrix gets formed by combination of all the, or you know, appending of all the element level coefficient matrices, and each of those element coefficient matrices is representing the corresponding energy of that element, is it not? So, the global coefficient matrix is representing the energy of the entire system. And of course, remember that the system of equation will also have now the corresponding this term, right? And that also will be deciding the overall energy of the system, because this will give you one matrix, this will also give you one matrix. So, this will give you K matrix, this will give you B matrix, right? The corresponding earlier, you know, we said K or whatever A matrix, but here what we are doing is that global coefficient matrix will call it by C, because already we have this variable A as magnetic vector potential. So, the global coefficient matrix here will denote it as capital C. So, our final system of equations will be C into A is equal to B, where unknowns are magnetic vector potentials AZ at various points in the domain, right? And then
for getting the linear system of equations, we need to minimize the total energy with respect to nodal magnetic vector potentials.
And then you apply the boundary condition, right? Now, the B matrix that you get, which we have seen earlier also in case of 1D, the contributions to that B matrix come from two, you know, accounts. One is the boundary condition, right? Other is this source condition. So, here that is why that B matrix will have contribution from J, which is the source, as well as the boundary condition that we are imposing, that A is equal to 0 on the outermost rectangular boundary. So, always remember the right hand side B matrix that we will eventually get when we do the FEM procedure, we will have contributions from source as well as boundary conditions, right. So, this should be understood. And of course, then we will get final matrix equation, linear system of equations C A equal to B, then you know you just have to take inverse to get the you know, unknown vector A, which is potentials at magnetic vector potentials at various nodes in the domain. Now, let us go one by one these steps. So, in first step we are discretizing. So, in 1D we will always generally have segments as we have seen earlier. In 2D you can have either triangular element or quadrilateral element, right? And in 3D you will have cubic, tetrahedral or prismatic element, right? Now, how do we decide element size? We had some discussion earlier when we saw theory of eddy currents and all that, or when we discussed non-uniform fields, we discussed this, that whenever there is a non-uniform field in some region, you have to have fine discretization, right? Similarly, when the frequency is high, eddy currents are there, and you know, current is confined to a small surface depth, then you need to have fine element size in that zone, so that you can capture the rapid variation of the field as well as loss. If the loss is occurring, power loss is occurring, if you have to capture that, then you need to have fine mesh in that region. So, those considerations will be there while deciding the size of the element. The type of the element gets decided based on whether it is 1D, 2D or 3D, and whether we should go for, you know, cubic, tetrahedral or prismatic for 3D, or triangular or quadrilateral for 2D is matter of convenience and coding. You know, for example, in this course we will always use triangular element because they are much simpler to code, and you know, process. Now let us go further. Second step is solution approximation. Now here you can have linear or quadratic elements, right? What is linear element? Linear element is for 1D, for example, it is a plus bx, it is a linear element, right? Whereas same thing, quadratic element for 1D will be a plus bx plus cx square, will be the quadratic element, right? And then for 2D, it will be a plus bx plus cy, linear element, whereas second order element or quadratic element will be this. Now here, the number of constants in the approximation is equal to the number of nodes in that element. For example, when it was 1D element, when it was just a segment, there were two nodes. So that is why you had a plus bx, so two constants, right? When now you have a triangular element, right? When you have a triangular element, you have three nodes. So you need to have three constants. Now why this is important? Eventually the linear system of equation that you solve, the number of unknowns should be equal to the number of equations that you get. So this will ensure if you have number of nodes in the element, in each element equal to the number of constants in the approximation, then this, that will get automatically ensured, right? So for example, a quadratic second 2D, quadratic 2D element, there are 6 constants, right? So there are correspondingly, there are 6 nodes, 1 at the 3 at the vertices and 3 at the middle of the corresponding 3 sides. Similarly, you will have, you know, quadrilateral element, 2D quadrilateral element like this, and then the corresponding approximation will be a plus bx plus cy plus dxy. So there are 4 constants here which are unknown for each element to be determined, right? And remember, we directly do not determine this a, b, c because we eliminate those and we convert the problem in which constants need to be determined. That problem we are converting into a problem wherein we directly determine the potential values. Is it not? Because we eliminate these constants, right? Again, we will see that procedure for this 2D case. And then, you know, a 3D tetrahedral element, it has got 4 nodes. Tetrahedron has got 4 nodes. So, you will have corresponding this expression. And for cubic element, a cube has 8 nodes. So, there should be, you know, 8 constants. So that is why you have this expression which has got now 8 constants. So this is a cubic element approximation, right? Now you know how, when to use which. For example, the question that would be asked, when do I use linear, when do I use quadratic? So if you are using linear element, then you have to use higher number of elements. When you are using quadratic elements,
you can use
lower number of, you know, nodes and corresponding elements. So, but which one would be better, one cannot say confidently because computational burden may be more or less same. So, it is matter of convenience, and so one may be comfortable in using higher number of first order elements as compared to a smaller number of second order elements. Because see, second order elements, although they are less in number, the expression is becoming more complex, is it not? And the number of nodes are here, they are actually increasing, right? So the complexity of the formulation is higher in case of second order or quadratic elements, although the number of elements are less, right? So the computational burden may be more or less same, right? It depends on the convenience of the person who is doing coding, right? And you will see in, that is why in commercial FE softwares also, both the options are generally available. The user has to basically choose whether he wants to use linear or quadratic, you know, elements, right? So going further, now third step is assembly of global system of equations. So for that, first we have to find global coefficient matrix. So for that, first we have to find element coefficient matrix. and then combine all the element coefficient matrices to form global matrix, right? So that is what we will do now. Now we here we'll have the, this is a we'll start with a one triangular element. The node numbers are numbered in anticlockwise direction. And why it is numbered in anticlockwise direction? Because then only eventually when we find out the area of triangle based on this simple, you know, later on we will see this triangle area is given by half of this determinant, is it not? It is a very standard formula. x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3 are the coordinates of vertices. So, if you do not actually number these nodes in anticlockwise,
and if you number them in clockwise direction,
then the area calculated by this will become negative. To avoid that, we always number the nodes in anticlockwise direction. Right. Now, using the approximation that we have for linear element, that is A is equal to A plus BX plus CY, like we did for 1D case, it is more or less same procedure. Now it is in two dimensions. So we write A1, A2 and A3. Now here again it is tilde, that means it is approximated solution, right. So these tildes, three tildes at three nodes will be simply A plus BX1 plus CY1 and likewise. Again, as we did in 1D code and 1D formulation, we eliminate ABC and express them in terms of nodal potential values, right. Effectively, what we are aiming for? The total energy of the system, instead of being function of all these individual ABCs of each element, the total energy will be function of the potential values at all the nodes in the system, because that makes it very simple, right. And in the variational procedure also we have been seeing, in the variational calculus and the corresponding minimization procedure, what we are varying is at every each of these nodes in the system, we vary the potential and we see for which combination of potentials we get minimum energy, is it not? So it is very logical that we eliminate this ABC from the formulation and express energy of each element in terms of the potentials of the three vertices, right. And then, you know, we have this problem domain is split into these many elements. Now again, you know, these are very nicely made out elements, triangular, because, you know, I want to explain you the FEM procedure on paper. But you know, if you use some commercial software, the elements will not be like this and not definitely so less in number, because I have got only one layer of element between this conductor and the outermost boundary. That means this solution is definitely going to be very, very approximate, is it not? Being only one layer of element between the conductor and this, is going to be very, very approximate. Why? Because you can imagine. Now A is this, right, the magnetic vector potential for any element is simply A plus BX plus CY. So actually B will be actually derivative of the magnetic vector potential. We will see when we expand B is equal to curl of A, the derivative of A will be there. We will see in one of the further lectures. So moment, that means what will happen if A is capital A, magnetic vector potential is A plus BX plus CY, right. And derivative of, if you take derivative with respect to X, it will be B, only B. Derivative with respect to Y, it will be only C, so constant. So the components of B, BX and BY will be constant, and hence the total overall magnitude of B will be constant in element. That means effectively what approximation we are doing here? In all these elements, B will be constant, which is not the case. So later on when we do complete the code, we will increase the number of elements here and then see how the solution improves, right. Okay, now going further, now capital A, which is magnetic vector potential, is we are approximated as A plus BX plus CY. So that we are actually writing it like 1 xy and abc, and then we basically in place of abc we replace what we have got already. So we replace it here, and we if we expand the inverse of this, you can express a as summation ni aie. So that is nothing but n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 a3, wherein n1 n2 n3 again are the shape functions which are functions of x and y as expressed here. Same thing we did for 1D, is it not? There also we had n1 n2 for each element, is it not, for the local coordinates 1 2. Here we have 3 nodes for every element, so we'll have 3 shape functions n1 n2 n3, right? If you expand this matrix, you will get
these expressions,
right? And here 1 upon 2 delta, this delta is the area of the triangle. So here again the same property holds as in 1D. The shape function of node 1 n1 at that node 1 will be equal to 1 and 0 at nodes 2 and 3, right? So same thing. Similarly, n2 will be 1 at node number 2, 0 at nodes 1 and 3, right? And in fact that you can substitute, for example n1, you substitute here x as x1 and y as y1, you will get this getting reduced to just 1, right? And if you substitute here x as x2 and y as y2, n1 you will get it as 0, you can verify. Similarly, you know, n2 and n3. Now we are ready to discuss why this is important, this property. Now let us take two adjacent or contiguous elements. Suppose this is, you know, element number 1 and this is element number 2. With, you know, global node numbers as 1, 2, 3, 4, right. Now by this property, the potential at nodes 2 and 3, as well as any point on this segment 2, 3 will be decided only by the potentials at 2 and 3 only, because n1 is 0 at nodes 2 and 3 and it is 0 at any point along 2, 3. That you can verify. You what can be done is you can take any arbitrary, you know, coordinates and form this, you know, two elements, right, and then get the expression of x and y on this segment, and then that you can put it here. You will find that n1 on this segment 2, 3 will also come 0. What I told previously, n1 at nodes 2 and 3 will be 0. By, you know, substituting here x2, y2 and x3, y3, you will get 0. To prove that at any other arbitrary point on segment 2 or 2, 3 also n1 will be 0, you can form an equation of this segment 2, 3, right, and then substitute x and y in terms of, you know, this potential x2, y2 and x3, y3, and then you will find that n1 at any arbitrary xy on this segment 2, 3 also is 0, right, that you can verify yourself. So what then it means? The potential at any point on this segment 2, 3 will be decided by only the potentials of nodes 2 and 3 only. Is it not? Because our that this formula is A at any point is n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 a3. So if at any of these points if n1 is 0, then potential at any point here will be decided by only n2 and n3. This should be the case, because if it was not so, suppose this node 1 and node 4 potentials, if they were deciding potentials on segment 2, 3, then what will happen? When you calculate the potential at any xy on this segment 2, 3 with reference to element 1, you will get one value. And when you calculate the potential on this segment 2, 3 with reference to this element number 2, then you will get another value, and mathematically it will be absurd, is it not? So it is very logical that the potential on this segment 2, 3 is decided by only the potential values at nodes 2 and 3. In other words, the continuity of potential across these element boundaries is ensured by this property of shape functions. So this is called as, you know, ensuring continuity of potential. That means whether you come from here or here, the potential has to be continuous at the interface, is it not? Otherwise, the formulation will be mathematically absurd, right? So this is now I just explained why, you know, n1 should be equal to 1 at node 1 and 0 at nodes 2 and 3. It is very obvious. AE at 1 will be n1 a1 plus n2 a2 plus n3 a3. But since n2 and n3 are 0 at node number 1, it will be a1. So a at 1 is a1. So it ensures similarly for the other two, right? And then here pictorially this shape function properties is given. So for example, this is our that triangular, if suppose these are that one of the triangular elements 1 2 3, so n1 will be equal to 1 at node number 1 and that will go to 0 at nodes 2 and 3, right? So somewhere in the middle of triangle, in anywhere in between, all n1 n2 n3 they will exist. Are you getting what I'm saying? So suppose you take some triangle like this, take any arbitrary point in the triangle, n1, n2, n3 all will be non-zero. If the point shifts towards node number 1, contribution of n1 will increase, contribution of n2 and n3 will reduce in deciding the potential of that point. It is very logical, is it not? It is more intuitive. Of course, it is by maths it will come, but it is intuitive. And when the point coincides with node 1, the potential of that point is solely decided by node 1, which is it not? Suppose the point is at centroid of this triangle, then n1, n2, n3 will all be equal to 1 by 3, is it not? That means all these potentials will have equal contribution in deciding the potential of that point. So it is like, you know, in other words, it is like averaging, is it not? It is averaging, right? So I think we will stop here and then we will continue in the next lecture.